Good morning and welcome to the 36th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received apologies for this meeting from Tess White. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. The second item on our agenda is a second oral evidence session as part of the committee's inquiry into healthcare in remote and rural areas. Today we'll be hearing from academics with expertise in rural health and wellbeing, nursing, geriatric care, delivery of rural healthcare and wider issues in remote and rural healthcare. And for this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Dr. Stephen Macken, Senior Clinical Lecturer, University of Aberdeen, and Honorary Consultant Geriatrician at NHS Highland. Dr. Rebecca McLean, Research Fellow, Division of Rural Health and Wellbeing, University of Highlands and Islands, and Professor Anetta Smith, Professor Emerita, University of the Highlands and Islands. And we will move straight to questions and to Carol Mochan.
Good morning to the panel. It's really great to have you here. And my first question really is quite general and is just to ask the panel whether they think that, and do we have a tendency to develop healthcare policy in a sort of urban-led way? And if that is the case, could you give us any indication as to why that causes a problem for us in terms of healthcare in more remote and rural areas? If we could go to maybe Professor Macken, Dr. Macken could start.
Thank you. I agree. I completely agree. I think we do have a tendency to develop healthcare for urban areas. I think there's a number of reasons for that. Largely because when we're developing healthcare interventions, it's usually done by clinical academics who are based in universities, and with the exception of me, I think, are work in big urban hospitals, and there's a tendency to forget that you have to deliver healthcare differently in a rural hospital. I'm a geriatrician and my subspecialty stroke, and we're struggling to deliver thrombectomies in rural areas because when that service was developed and the evidence was developed, it was all developed in big urban centres. And just thinking of the basics of how I'm practising case nurse and there is thrombectomy is Dundee, how am I going to get, and you have to do it in 6 hours, how do we even select the right patients to go to Dundee and when? And we're really operating in almost an evidence-free zone. So in terms of solutions, I'm Bob, as a clinical academic who works in a rural area, I try and personally just stay involved and get involved and in trials, and I often am the one that puts my hand up and says, that's not going to work in a rural area for various proposals. But it does contribute to inequality because it's like we're on a different planet. Sometimes you feel the evidence is for a different planet.
Thank you. Sorry, somebody's unmuted me there. I don't know whether Dr. Macken or Professor Smith would have anything to add to that at all.
Yeah, thank you. I completely agree with Dr. Macken. And I would say that every part of the patient's journey from diagnosis to treatment to accessibility to treatment is affected by the context in which the patient is situated. And even within a rural area, whether it's remote, rural or island, even that context differs as well. So while some patients are living rurally, their access to hospital care can be quite efficient. For others who are living a distance from that hospital in the same rural area, the experience can be quite different. So while there are differences between urban and rural contexts, there are also differences within remote, rural and island contexts. And I think, you know, in terms of policy making and decisions around healthcare, that is why it's absolutely vital that clinicians that are delivering care and also patients that are receiving care in these areas are part of that decision making and modelling for what's going to happen. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think Dr. Mackin's indicated she will come in.
Hello, sorry, it's Dr. McLean. I think I just wanted to agree with both the other members of the panel and to just say that our research in rural health at UHI has really identified the key issues that are needed within this work to support rural health and rural healthcare. The work is still needed to design and embed models of service delivery that overcome the disadvantages of geographical distance. So like Professor Smith was saying about the issues of transport and transportation and access and availability. We still haven't yet overcome the challenges of recruitment and retention of rural workforce, with particularly shortages of people choosing to enter rural general practice. And there is still work to be done to integrate digital technology into rural healthcare delivery to ensure that it's acceptable to patients and healthcare providers.
Thank you for that. Apologies for saying your name. I would be interested to know just a wee bit about the research community, because it was touched on a wee bit. Is there things that we can do in terms of making sure that research is happening in rural areas, or is it about being connected in with research as it happens, but making sure rural areas are involved in that? Somebody want to come back on that?
I'm happy to come back on that. I think it's a bit of both, actually. I think there's issues with rural research being included in large-scale studies and projects that are funded, but also the funding itself to actually conduct rural research and going into rural areas and travelling these distances to meet with the communities, engage with communities, which we have found in our research is so important, that the communities and the people that are involved in this decision-making are involved, both healthcare providers and the patients and community members themselves. That is actually quite costly to go and to conduct this research. And I think it's about supporting those costs, unfortunately, that sometimes can be higher than those in urban centres. When we're looking at researching and travelling these distances to speak to people in dispersed geographical areas in Scotland.
Yeah, that makes sense. Does anybody else want to add to that? I don't have any more sort of general questions. If somebody wants to come in or move on.
Yeah, I'll come in if that's okay. Thank you. You know, I think that any decisions that are made around clinical practice need to be based on good evidence, and I don't think anyone would argue with that. And you know what Dr. McLean was saying was quite right. It's important that we have the ability to conduct remote and rural research and the resources to do that, so we get to the heart of what communities want. But we also need to take account of existing research. So you know, there's a vast body of research there around remote and rural practice. You know, there's a lot of international research that we should take notice of. There's a lot of innovative solutions that others have used that we could also consider as well. So it's looking at the existing research base that is there, but also, as Dr. McLean said, you know, ensuring that decisions are made where we are able to access local communities in terms of furthering that evidence base and what is best for them. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much. And can I just ask a supplementary to Professor Smith there? You mentioned that there is international research, and I'm thinking of other countries that have very remote communities, Australia, Canada. Are we using the research that's been done there for their rural and remote communities, or are we overlooking some of that?
I think there's... I don't think we use it as well as we could. I'm not sure the context when we're looking at remote and rural international research can be quite different. So sometimes we've got more in common, for example, with our Scandinavian countries than perhaps some of the other remote and rural areas. But there are excellent models that we could learn from. So, you know, as an example, I'm thinking about the extensive work that's been done in Northern Ontario with their medical school and the ability to recruit local people to train as doctors so they remain and work and live in the areas that they trained in Northern Ontario. So that's one example, but there are plenty of examples of innovative solutions to workforce and healthcare delivery that we could really learn from.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to move to David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to witnesses. You've touched on it earlier with one of your answers, but how important should community engagement and co-production play in the development of rural health services, and what types of benefits of this? And I'll go to Dr. McLean first, please.
Yeah, so we have seen in our research in rural health at UHI that it's extremely important. Its co-design is so important for the development of rural healthcare services, with community members and local healthcare professionals being involved in this. It's important to understand their viewpoints and for them to have an opinion and be involved in the design of services that people find acceptable and affordable. We find from projects, a Being Here project, which redesigned primary care models in several Highland communities, that this was really important. And we've also found from the literature review that the ethos of this sort of engagement is as important as the particular methods used. So this sort of engagement needs to be done in a way that ensures the community feels supported and listened to, and that they have ownership and appropriate representation, so that this design of healthcare is not being done to them, but it's been done with them and working with them. And that's been highlighted across all our different types of research that we do in rural health.
Any other witnesses like to comment? No. Can I ask then, of the examples that are in place, how could we strengthen them? And what good examples are there out there that we could share across the rest of Scotland?
I think as well as engagement with the local community through research, as Dr. McLean has just outlined, there are also very good structures in place within communities where we can make sure that communities are actively involved in planning. For example, through using local planning groups, which are quite active throughout some remote and rural communities. And it's also absolutely vital to include the third sector in that engagement as well, as they are very much partners in care delivery. So when we're looking at community engagement, we're looking at it in its broadest sense, both through formal, informal, and research opportunities.
Any other witnesses? No further questions.
Okay, Dr. Mackin, were you looking to come in there?
Only to agree with what the other witnesses have said is that without community engagement, the services, if you're designing a new service without community engagement, it will be yet another. It's unlikely to be valued, and it's unlikely to meet the needs of the community. There's numerous examples of well-designed services with community engagement and poorly designed services where it's not happened. It's really an essential part.
Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Convener. I wondered if I could ask a brief supplementary to Professor Smith. As a board member at NHS Ellen this year, I just wondered if you would have a specific example. I think it's good to hear about the principles, but if there's a specific example from the Western Isles that would add a bit of colour to our discussion, that would be helpful.
Just now I'm thinking about the re-engagement of local planning groups. So post-COVID, the local planning groups are just starting to really, not all of them, but some of them starting to re-engage. So I think probably Dr. Mackin is going to come in with an example.
Dr. Mackin, yep.
Thank you. I'm sure that have been many examples in Highland, in your health board, but in Highland, there's been two examples I can think of in Caithness, one where it's gone well and one where it could have gone better. The local maternity service in Caithness General, so which is a two and a half hour drive from Inverness, was downgraded to a midwife-led unit about 2016 without any concept, largely because of concerns about safety, of immediate safety of babies. But there was not a lot of consultation with the community about the fact that we couldn't, it was felt by NHS Highland, just couldn't provide a safe consultant-led service. And there's still a lot of resentment within the community and anger, and with justifiable reason, because the experiences of mothers and babies is driving 2.5 hours in labour. I've never had a baby, but I suspect that would not be a easy thing to do. And I think we could have been, it's difficult because there's a degree of urgency there, if there's patient safety issues, but we could have engaged more with explaining to the community what the difficulties were and looking at the different options. We've recently redesigned services for older people with a lot more community engagement, and it's gone much better. And the proposed model of service of a community hub for intermediate care is being valued, I believe, as a valuable service people want to engage with. And even though we're moving services from the acute hospital to the community, it's not being seen as bed closures, it's seen as opening of a new service, which it is, even though we are reducing the acute hospital beds by two. And I suspect involving the community in the dilemma of why we can't, the problems with the existing service would have been helpful for the first example.
Can I ask, I'm aware of the first example, and I think it is slightly different when we're talking about safety concerns. Mm. So if we can move to the other one,
yeah,
where you've said there's been good practice. You said there's been engagement with the community. What did that look like? Who did the health board speak to? How did they do it?
It's been a long process, and it started before I joined in 2019. But there were a series of, we've got the local health action team, which is a pressure group, which we really do engage with. There were a series of events that designed the service really at the very early stages before the appointment of contractors or consultants, when we designed a specification, where there was representatives from almost every local community group we could think of. It felt like there was almost everyone there. Certainly the local health pressure group, the voluntary groups, the local council and care agencies, but also charity and third sector groups. And it felt like everyone had a voice there. And the service was designed from a very basic level at those events. What do we want from a service? But also, where should things be delivered? What would good look like? And that was before, it was about 2 years before we even appointed an architect or had a term of specification for the service. It didn't feel tokenistic at all.
Dr. Mackin, sorry to interrupt. Mm-hmm. Can I just ask, had the decision to move the services to a community-based setting already been taken, and this was about designing what they looked like, or was it the public's input that led to it? Which way round was it?
It was, I will be honest and say this happened 2 years, 3 years before I joined the health board, the initial decision. Okay. Shortly after the maternity service, there was a top-down decision to move services to a community-based setting that didn't, and there were protests in the street, I think, as a result of that. Mm-hmm. So they stopped that and then looked at doing service redesign. As part of that, they did have a presentation about the unsustainability of the current service model and why it was something that they didn't feel could be sustained. But actually, during the consultation, there were far better models of service, that we were delivering services in hospital that could be delivered in people's homes. And actually, when you put it to people, no one wanted to be in hospital when they could have been at home. So I think the mutual feeling that actually it could be better. But no, I don't think the initial plan to move services to a community setting was made in a top-down way. There's no consultation, and this was a reaction to that.
Thank you, that's helpful.
Can I just ask a brief supplementary on that? So you spoke there, Dr. Makin, about co-production, about community engagement and redesign of services. And this might not be specifically a question for yourself, it might be for other panel members. But what's the difference between redesigning services that way in a remote and rural setting compared to an urban setting?
I'll be honest and say I've never designed a service in an urban setting. I suspect it's easier in a remote and rural setting because you can almost get everyone, you can't almost get everyone in one room, but it's a bit more of a connected community. And I think it was easier to identify the people that needed to be invited. So I suspect of a more connected community, it's easy to identify them, but I'd be very interested in hearing the rest of the panel's views.
Dr. McLean, do you want to come in?
Hi, yes, I think it's that issue of touched on earlier with taking an urban model and trying to put it into a rural area, and the difference in getting people who live in more remote rural areas understandings and experiencings of healthcare and accessing healthcare can be very, very different to those in urban settings. So that might be the difference between the urban and rural divide within that. So that the difference in getting people to engage is to understand what works for them and not necessarily taking a model from urban areas and putting it into a rural area and thinking that will work and understanding why that is. So we've done some work, particularly with mental health issues, highlighting that really rural residents are concerned about what they perceive as a lack of mental health services. And we used community engagement methods and a consensus building exercise on rural mental health needs in the Western Isles and in the Black Isle. And residents themselves recognised a need for preventative and police-based integrated NHS and third sector mental health services that would work for them in their local area and also within their geographic area, how they will get to access these services. So that's an important aspect of service design when we're looking at the difference between rural and urban. And a lot of it is to do with the geographical distances and what's the availability of services, which is the difference between the urban and urban settings. You've maybe got much more availability. And also if somebody doesn't want to go to one particular place, there's another choice for them to go to, whereas in more remote rural areas, that isn't always the case. And there's one service that's accessible, if that, in some cases.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on now to Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Dr. McLean, I'd like to hear a bit more about the work you did on mental health services. One of the themes raised in response to the committee's views was very much around mental health and addiction services, and people spoke about their concerns, as you say, about lack of availability. I think issues around waiting lists and access were raised in a number of submissions. They also spoke about health inequalities and deprivation, I mean, things that are actually common across the country, I suppose. And I think your points there about the services that people are looking for in rural areas, I think people in urban areas would very much also appreciate preventative community-based work. You spoke about the model you used when engaging with the community. Did you consensus building or exercise, or can you speak a bit more to that so we can understand what happened?
Yeah, so I have to say this actually was my colleague who couldn't be here today who conducted this research, so I can't really speak to the full detail, but it's a consensus building, so it's called a Delphi, modified Delphi method, which basically you use a consensus, you use some statements that people disagree with and agree with, and then you keep going round and see what people agree with the most, so you gain consensus that way. You can also have people sort of rank what their priorities are, and then you keep going around in sort of a circular mode with all different community members to find out whether there's consensus in that, and that we find that that's been a with community members has been a really effective way to understand both healthcare providers but also patients and community groups' views, because sometimes they can differ about what their priorities are. So patient priorities can differ very much to what healthcare providers' priorities are, and then both being in groups and seeing that and visualising what each one's opinions are can actually really help to build consensus in these areas.
Thank you.
I hope that's made sense.
It does make sense. It does, absolutely. Did you say that work was done in the Black Isle?
And the Western Isles.
So, and how did the health board respond to that work? Was there any change in the services to the citizens living there?
That I couldn't tell you yet. It's fairly recent work, so I'm not sure of any changes being made as a result of that work.
Okay, thank you. Moving on, some respondents highlighted that a whole system approach to policy action is necessary. Could one of the panel members tell me what a whole system approach is and how that could be used to the benefit of people living in rural areas?
I can speak to that and give an example if that's okay. And I guess the most pressing example just now we have is around recruitment and retention of health care and social care staff throughout the Highlands and Islands, and in some places it is more acute than others, but it is pretty concerning everywhere. And I think maybe it's easier for me just to give an example of the Western Isles as to how that whole systems approach would work. So the difficulties of recruitment are tied up not just in the availability of health and social care professionals, but also in the infrastructure that supports people to live and work in the Western Isles. That includes everything from schooling to wraparound childcare to transport to accessibility, cost of living, digital structures, connectivity. All these challenges have been extremely well rehearsed, and we know they are for health boards and for council. They are quite key considerations. So if we're to look at recruiting health and social care staff, it's not just the availability of staff, it's how they live, they work and thrive in, for example, the Western Isles, and the structures are there to support that. If they're not, people simply won't come because they can choose to go elsewhere where they have more ready access to services. So in terms of a whole systems approach, you know, that's one example. You know, we can try as hard as possible to recruit staff, but if the social structures aren't there to support people to live and work in the islands, then staff won't come. So, you know, that's one example of a whole systems approach. Things cannot be addressed in isolation. The whole context has to be considered.
Thank you. I suppose in the Highlands that housing will play quite a big part in that as well.
Housing.
And is there any work going on at the moment to address that, those matters? What work are the health board and the local authority doing?
Well, there's been a lot of work done in terms of mapping the population. There's a significant concern, as I'm sure many of the committee know, about depopulation. And the demographic differences, for example, in the Western Isles are more stark than they are in other remote and rural areas, although that is also an issue in other remote and rural areas. So it's working. It is not something that the islands, for example, can address themselves. It needs to be done in partnership with both Scottish and UK governments.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the panel for their contributions so far. Just wanted to pick up on the service levels issue. The CAMHS target is for 90% of patients to be seen within 18 weeks of referral, but this target has never been met nationally. But do the panel have any particular insights in what waiting times are like in rural areas vis-a-vis urban areas in Scotland? Perhaps Professor McLean, do you have any thoughts on that?
Hello. I don't have those figures available about the waiting times between CAMHS. I do know there are significant waiting times in NHS Highland for CAMHS for young people, and that is an issue that's been repeatedly highlighted by service providers and by young people and their families themselves about the waiting times for CAMHS, but I don't have the figures off my head between urban and rural areas.
No problem. Dr. Machen, do you have any insights at all that would be helpful?
I don't have the figures to hand, and I couldn't easily find them by Googling whilst Dr. McLean was speaking either.
No problem.
I think you have to look a little bit broader than waiting times, in that if there isn't a service available, there's not going to be a waiting list for it. I know this sounds stupid, but there are many instances where the service that can be offered is just not accessible, so people won't be referred for it. And if people on an island would have to travel to the mainland to get an operation, and they elect not to have it because it's not available, because they don't want to travel or the travel isn't accessible, then just looking at the waiting times is going to mask that. Sorry to always drag myself back to Cation Escott, hey? In some rural areas, for instance, we don't have any care at home services available, and most of my patients in those areas, because we know there's no care at home, it isn't always requested. They just choose to go straight into a care home. But I've had to kind of start asking my team to just put the care at home request in, so we've got a waiting. You can see the need for it. But yeah, where service isn't accessible, there won't be referrals, so you won't necessarily see a waiting list.
Are you aware of any geographic deserts with regards to CAMHS provision in rural settings in Scotland?
As a geriatrician, no, I'm not.
No.
Because it's not, I don't treat children.
No, that's fair enough. It was just maybe as a general insight. Professor Smith, do you have any insights on CAMHS provision in rural settings?
No, there's nothing I can add that the others haven't already said. I don't have ready access to the figures, although we know that demand does exceed supply.
Okay. Health inequalities have also come up a lot during the consultation process, and we know that people from areas of high deprivation have poorer health outcomes but are also less likely to accept offers of care and engage with health services. Do the panel have a view on how we reach those people and address health inequalities in rural areas specifically? Perhaps Professor Smith, coming back to you.
I think Dr. Machen gave a very good example when he talked about community engagement in Caithness. So, you know, you're talking about, again, you know, a whole systems approach where you can encourage community engagement. I think the difficulty is there will always be people that are harder to reach, so and that are less likely to engage with, for example, preventative care. So it's coming up with ideas and solutions that will ensure that those that are less accessible or less likely to seek help are supported to do so.
I just wondered maybe, Dr. Mackin, have you had any insights on it? Obviously, your work with geriatric patients will show a lifetime of the consequences of inequalities. Do you see that quite starkly in rural settings?
A little more starkly there, but in rural settings, I think what is important is when we come up with a new model of service, we do a thorough equality impact assessment. I think examples can help. NHS near me is a great service for video consultations. To use it at home in a rural area, you need to have expensive broadband. If you're not on fibre optic broadband, I personally am not, I'm talking to you from a non-fibre optic broadband house because I pay £50 a month to get mobile broadband. When I try and do a video clinic, most of my patients can't actually, their broadband isn't good enough for a video call. So we just end up talking on the phone, which kind of negates the whole, isn't the same. And by moving our service to video, we're creating more digital inequality, we're exacerbating socioeconomic inequalities. Again, we're reducing it in other ways for people who can't travel, but I don't know if an equality impact assessment would pick that up.
Okay, thanks very much. And Professor McLean.
Thank you. You've just upgraded me to professor. I just wanted to speak a bit to inequalities and just talking a bit about our mixed methods research that we did this year with younger people in the Western Isles and the interconnection between reproductive and sexual health and wellbeing and mental wellbeing. It's really identified that adolescents living in remote rural and island communities require further support, and young LGBTQIA plus young people are more likely to express this need. So the findings of this study identified that the intersectionality of being LGBT plus and residing in the remote rural context might increase the experience of inequality in health and wellbeing support that's accessible for them and to support mental wellbeing. So for example, 68% of all young people in this study said that they'd witnessed LGBT plus bullying, and this increased to 86% for those actually identifying themselves as LGBTQIA plus. So fears of judgment and stigma from the local community and a lack of anonymity and availability can inhibit access to health protective behaviours and support. So again, this study is looking at health inequity, but also identifying the real need for place-based health and wellbeing support for young islanders in particular. And the support should be co-produced with these young people living in the local and social context to able to counteract this health inequity that these young people in particular are experiencing.
That's really helpful insight. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. What impact is an ageing population currently having on the healthcare services in remote and rural areas? And as we see that ageing population increase, how is that likely to continue to affect services? And could I go to Dr. Mackin first, please?
The ageing population is having a profound effect on services. Our core customer base, if we were providing customer service, is the older person. 80% of our inpatients are older, and the need for healthcare is, those people need healthcare. And in terms of the challenges, there's a number of them. One of the challenges is that it's not just the increase in older people in rural areas, it's the decrease in younger people. And if your family are 500 miles away, they can't help you when you need help. And if there are no jobs for younger people, but the older people stay, there's no one to look. Often their family aren't there. They're more likely to stay in hospital as a delayed discharge after a minor illness. They've got no family to help them. It's exacerbated, I feel, by people moving. I mean, incoming retirees who contribute a lot to the community. But I'm going to quote a relative of one of my patients who said, you move 500, you move 600 miles away, mum. Why should I? I can't drop everything every time you get sick. Yeah. If you've moved away from your family and your social network, when you're ill, you often need to have more health and social care services to recover. And if the incoming retirees have increased the health problems to the point... Sorry, my dog is having a son. Shut up. Please be quiet. This is a bit embarrassing. If the incoming retirees have increased the health prices and then younger people aren't able to stay in the area, who is going to care for them?
Do any of the other panel members want to come in on that at all before I move on?
Yes, you know, I would like to just mention one more thing. You know, older people, they're the greatest consumers of health and social care. And as absolute numbers increase, there will be increased pressure on health services and budget. And budget allocations don't necessarily take account of patient profile, they take account of numbers. So if your demographics suggest that you have a greater number of older people than younger people in the population, they are going to consume much more of that health and social care budget. You know, we know about availability of health and social care workers to support older people and the difficulties associated with that in remote and rural areas that Dr. Matkin has alluded to. But there's also the fundamentals of how we actually resource that increasing requirement to support older people in health and social care settings.
Thank you. In terms of designing services, what do we need to do now to address the ageing population, and what current barriers are there to designing services that would meet the needs of older people in remote and rural areas? And I'll maybe go back to Dr. Mackin first.
Thank you. When it comes to designing services, she is a therapy dog in a local care home. The biggest barrier, I think, the main issue has just been acknowledgement. It costs more to provide services in rural areas. I know that sounds stupid, that sounds obvious, but it's not always reflected in the funding model that if we want to provide services in rural areas, it's going to cost a bit more. You have to cover the travel times, for instance, or you come up with a new model where it doesn't work in quite the same way. In terms of barriers, the obvious barriers are if you set up a community engagement event in a town, housebound people from the villages aren't going to be able to come to it. That's a fairly obvious barrier. I do potentially think you have to really work with people who know the community and work out who is going to be the core users and go to them. I actually think it's a little easier in rural areas to identify the core people and work out who is going to use this service and make sure they come along. And too often community engagement, it's the same familiar faces that come to every event, and we very much appreciate their contribution. But often I find it's the same people at every community engagement event, even if whatever service we're discussing. And they put a lot of time and effort in, and we value their contribution. But we maybe need to be a bit more proactive about this.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Professor McLean. Dr. McLean. Yeah.
I just wanted to sort of speak to some evaluation that we've recently done. In terms of ageing well for non-pharmaceutical interventions that are linked to social prescribing dimensions and the social dimensions of health. We conducted an evaluation of technology-enabled social prescribing for rural older people, and this was in Scotland, in Ireland and in Northern Ireland. And this identified that the format was particularly effective at improving patient-reported outcome measures for those with depression, chronic pain and chronic kidney disease, which may both be related to depressive symptoms, did have the least effect for frailty and dementia. But in the evaluation, 60% of those with depression decreased their level of loneliness before and after the social prescribing, and 48% said that their life satisfaction had increased. We've got a full report of that as well, if the panel would be interested. And this is about the technology-enabled social prescribing. We're also currently doing ongoing work at UHI and Rural Health to evaluate the community link worker social prescribing model in NHS Highland. And alongside other variables, this work's looking at collecting the demographics of the population who's uptaking that social prescribing service and how this translates into more rural and remote settings as well. We know it's been positively evaluated in more urban settings, but we're looking to see how this might support the ageing population in more remote rural areas. So that should hopefully, the initial findings are expected in July 2024 of that research.
That's really useful, thank you. And if those could be sent, any of those pieces of work that you've referenced can be sent on to the committee, I'm sure we'd all be really grateful to see those as well. So thanks, convener, if there's no one.
Thank you. Ivan McKee.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to touch on the area of technology and digital services. And we've kind of touched on that slightly already with regards to some comments on the potential for that to exacerbate inequalities. But there I'd like to focus on is understanding what role new and emerging technologies can play in supporting in the rural environment. And I think that clearly the need for those technologies is probably greater in that environment, which I suppose gives the potential for them to be rolled out more rapidly in the remote and rural areas. So I suppose I'd just like to understand what you see in terms of those technologies happening and what else could be done to further roll them out. And I suppose we're talking about digital connectivity, but also things like medicine delivery by drones or sensor technology in homes or any across a wide range of technologies you may be aware are in use. I don't know who wants to come in on that first.
I can make a start. And I'm just saying this is not necessarily my area of expertise. But I mean, the role of technology in remote and rural areas is undisputed, really, and it can certainly be used to enhance services, not always replace services. And I think that's what's important to remember. It does feel like we're on the cusp of a technological revolution in terms of supporting people to live at home and delivery of medical care. But we have already mentioned that it's important to get, when we talked about a whole systems approach, so it's good that the technology is there, it's developing, the possibilities about what it can do are exciting. But, you know, the infrastructure, broadband speed, the network coverages have to be in place first, you know. So it's quite difficult when exciting things are promised, but they're not then deliverable because of the reasons that, again, we know. And we've talked a lot about older people living in remote and rural areas as well, and we know they are less likely to use technology, and that access will decrease with age. I think I'm just going to say something as well that I've been thinking about for quite a while. I think some of the terms that we sometimes use around technology and the possibilities of technology aren't always seen as the most positive. So, for example, you know, we talk about remote medicine. Now, for me as a clinician, as an academic, the possibilities of remote medicine are exciting, and it means that people can get access to expert clinical opinion and not necessarily have to travel. But I think the whole concept of remote medicine sometimes is seen as a negative. Mm-hmm. I would like to see remote medicine being called accessible medicine. So it's turning, you know, I don't want to feel like I'm remote from my clinician. I want to feel like I'm accessible to my clinician. So I think as well, in terms of public perception, the terminology we use to describe the technology can be reconsidered. So it's seen as advantageous rather than accentuating the distance between you and the healthcare professionals.
Thank you. That's very helpful. And I think that point is well made in thinking about this in a more positive light. And seeing remote and rural communities being at the forefront of adopting this technology, which then rolls out more widely, I think is perhaps a helpful way to look at it. Anyone else want to come in? Dr. Mackin.
Dr. Yep. I'm just wondering if Dr. McLean wanted to come in.
Hi, sorry, trouble unmuting there. Yeah, I just wanted to talk to a bit of work that we've done on the with NHS Highland on the Tech Pathfinder project on respiratory pathways using digital approaches and the root causes that can actually digital approaches we find that can help tackle or important issues that have been identified. So that data needs to be in the right place at the right time for that. It's not always successfully shared between different parts of the healthcare system, so between primary and secondary care, or accessible to patients themselves. Patients want to be able to access information online in one digital place. They don't want to have to go to different places. They want to have one place where they can access their support, but also their own information. And also enhanced patient experience can come from more confident, informed healthcare staff about using these technologies themselves. I think that's really important through digitally enabled formats. We did some work on the use of VC consultations that Dr. Mackin had talked about, the near me system in remote communities, and also just with digital service design. This was in communities in Skye. And this identified, again, the importance of co-production with digital service design in remote areas. Public members really identified and provided insights on how the community could use Near Me at Home, which otherwise wouldn't have been unknown if we hadn't done that piece of work with the community. So the patients and public hold unique perspectives when it comes to accessing digital health services and how they can be designed to fit into their communities. So, for example, this piece of work that we did with individuals on Sky, some people were able to access from home, but also some people came to a healthcare clinic, so the local GP, or even sometimes in a more community centre, sometimes local public library, sometimes in really remote places. All these things are all in one place anyway, and to access their online Near Me appointment rather than doing it home, so that someone, they had problems with technology, they didn't have broadband, then they could actually access and sit in a room in this local community place, and if they had problems, there would be somebody on hand to actually help them with accessing this. So that was seen as quite an effective way of using this digital service for community members.
Okay, and just kind of explore that a wee bit further. I think what you're saying, I think this kind of came up earlier in the session as well, through necessity, redesign of service delivery in the remote and rural setting is perhaps more advanced, as I say, through necessity than it might be elsewhere. And I suppose I'd just like to understand, what extent do you feel through technology or service redesign, remote and rural health boards and areas are leading the way with technology and processes that then get adopted elsewhere? Or is that not really part of the consciousness in terms of how things are developing? I suppose what I'm saying is, are you always feeling at the back of the queue because you're remote and rural, or other areas where you feel kind of more at the front of the queue because you're developing these technologies and processes in advance of anywhere else?
I think in some ways, with that project with Near Me and Sky, I felt like we were a bit more in front of the queue in that area. But I think for other other areas. It's a bit of both, really. But I think there is really important learning, and I think there's so much potential for the use of digital technologies or accessible technologies in these areas that we could lead the way on.
Great, thank you. Dr. Mackin, did you want to come back in?
I was going to add that the NEMI example, the other thing is, I think the answer is in a previous question, if a technology is co-produced and implemented well, then it's going to be likely to be accessible. And one of the reasons I think NEMI was a success is I believe it was very heavily co-produced, which is, although during COVID, people without broadband couldn't access it, very often people without... now people can go to the local health centre and use a NEMI room. It is more accessible, and it was co-produced. If something is co-produced properly, it's likely to be accessible because the community will raise the issues.
Right. OK, thank you very much. Thank you.
Paul Sweeney.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks to the panel so far. Just wanted to pick up on a point that was raised briefly by Dr. Mackin earlier when he discussed the limitations on consultation using digital devices because of the lack of fibre broadband or high bandwidth broadband. You said that potentially worsens health inequalities because of the less likelihood of people in low incomes to be able to afford the premium broadband service that you described you required. Do you feel that there's some intervention required from a healthcare perspective to temporarily make available enhanced broadband services to those people who are experiencing difficulty connecting and would require that sort of face-to-face, more intense digital connection? Is there some mechanism perhaps you think might be useful to provide availability for a high-quality satellite broadband service for people in particularly rural areas who are finding it challenging? Is that something that might be useful?
I think improved rural broadband would be useful for many reasons. Nonetheless, improved access to remote employment, which would improve health for many people. But within NHS Highland, there is the option to access video consultations at your local health centre if you don't have your own broadband. I do not know how many people who can't access those then can't access limited. If the technology was there to improve broadband for a shorter period of time for someone who needed an intense period this mental health treatment that couldn't be provided remotely, that they couldn't go out, that then I think that could be useful in some settings. I'm thinking particularly, you referenced CAMS. I'm afraid to say this is something I've heard from a friend whose child tried to access CAMS and didn't, was that if it's travelling a long distance for group therapy is difficult, if it was being offered remotely and you don't have the broadband, maybe it's something that could be offered in the short term. I don't know how you do that technologically at all.
And neither do I. It was just maybe conceptually an idea worth exploring further. But thanks for that insight. That's a helpful insight. I know there's been some discussions of good practice so far, but one of the things that seems to be a recurring theme is pockets of good practice which don't necessarily get scaled up well across the service. Do you have any insights as to what barriers there might be institutionally to capturing good practice and then trying to scale it up across a wider territory? I know Dr. Mackin, you've just spoken, so perhaps maybe any of your colleagues have a thought initially on that, but we can always come back to you. Anyone? Feel free to chip in if you've got a thought on that.
I think the main value you can develop pockets of good practice can be developed by a small group of enthusiasts without a lot of funding. It's quite hard to then get to scale it up. Can be more challenging just because getting the funding and the funding environment's difficult. And often these pockets of good practice were done by enthusiasts without any specific funding for that work, that Dr. McLean has just probably got, wanted to come in.
I was just going to say that the pockets of good practice is a lot of them are being conducted by the third sector, not NHS. So there are a lot of really good third sector organisations who are supporting people's health. So sometimes we don't necessarily know about what's going on. I think that's one of the things, is about knowing what they're doing and finding out maybe through word of mouth or through rural remote communities, kind of work like that. Sometimes you find out that there's a really good third sector organisation that's really supporting people's health well and has a really good model. So it's about actually investigating and understanding how that works and then taking that learning from that. And sometimes that can be a bit of a barrier if it's a third sector but it's not an NHS organisation. I think also across rural remote areas, what I'm thinking of is for young people in particular, there are different models within different health boards for what young people can access. So there's not always across the board equity at all about what young people can access, and some people in certain areas of remote rural Scotland can access services for the mental well-being, for the sexual health, for instance, much more accessible than other young people in other remote rural areas. And that seems to be an issue where there's not a set of guidelines or a set of best practice, evidence-based practice to support that, which I think would be something that should be investigated and looked into for supporting certain sections of the population's health and well-being in remote rural areas.
So this be kind of like, headhunters within the NHS are going around looking for pockets of best practice and opportunities to scale up, or I would say maybe some, it's not quite angel investors, but you know what I mean, people who would be going around trying to identify opportunities and how they can be benchmarked and brought into a broader basis within the service. Is that what you're saying?
Possibly, but also just, you know, working with the communities and what they find is most supportive for them. But usually third sector organisations are very good at community development and doing that. So they're, when they're doing it well, they're normally, have got a very good model. So it'd be to maybe look at some of that and take the learning from that.
That's great. Thanks.
Thank you. The committee's heard, obviously, from other submissions and from other panels about workforce shortages, difficulties recruiting in remote and rural areas. So I'm not going to ask you specifically about recruitment, but I suppose I'm keen to hear from yourselves as academics about how you would see training opportunities and learning opportunities for staff in remote and rural settings, how you would see that as attracting people to stay, to come and live and work in those communities. I don't know if Professor Smith, if you want to start off on that one.
Yeah, thank you. I think workforce training and education is absolutely pivotal to, you know, as well as the other things that we spoke about, to attracting and retaining staff in remote and rural areas. I think there are many aspects of this. We need to ensure that healthcare professionals are not professionally isolated and maintain skills that are very often more general than their urban counterparts may use as well. So we need to ensure that there are robust training and education opportunities available. It's also important to have clear professional progression opportunities, and that's for nurses, doctors, AHPs, but also the unregulated workforce as well. So there is opportunity for people to develop, because we have to capitalise, for want of a better word, on the population that we have and that are working in health and social care. And it's really important that we provide development opportunities for these staff so they will stay and work in the areas where they are. I think locally accessible training is absolutely vital. And I'd like to just illustrate one example, if I may, about how we can address both training and education and recruitment opportunities. And if we have ensure that students who are in training have access to remote and rural placements, so they get a taste of what remote and rural healthcare is like. And if we make these placements as good as they can be and they are supported, then there may be an increased likelihood that we will attract some of these professionals back into remote and rural areas. I do think myself that it is really important to have students access that experience and a taste of remote and rural practice. And sometimes we have to be a little bit pragmatic as well, because it may be that that experience will mean that a healthcare professional will come and work in a remote and rural area for 2 or 3 years. They might not stay there forever. So I think we have to look at how we can maximise the opportunities through education, through training, through placement opportunities, and make these as best as they can be to encourage people to come and work in remote and rural areas and not feel like they're going to work in a backwater and that their professional careers are going to stagnate. That it needs to be the opposite, that it's got to be seen as exciting professionally and with opportunity, education and training built in.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else want to add anything to what Professor Smith has said on that subject? Dr. Meakin?
Easy to... Actually, this is an area where new technologies have made a big difference in that it's a lot... Well, I wouldn't be able to come to this committee if it wasn't for remote technology. I just couldn't. And it's a lot easier to stay in touch, it's a lot easier to work remotely, and it's a lot easier to not be professionally isolated. I never thought I could be a clinical academic and live and work in Wick. I just didn't. I do think, and I don't think, when my own job came about because I was a clinical academic and I brought a holiday cottage here, and one of the managers from NHS Highland tried to recruit me and actually made an academic job for me, which would involve a lot of creative thinking. But it does mean not only am I taking the lead on medical students and supervising PhDs, I hope that from coming from a teaching hospital and being in touch with the research community, the students don't feel they're in a backwater. They feel they're getting up-to-date training. And I know there's a lot of clinical academics aren't the only solution to rural healthcare, but if we further embedding clinical academics in rural healthcare, if there's more of us and we're willing to come, I think it could add a lot, and I think it really helps with training. Just being on a steering committee of a trial, if you're not in a teaching hospital, just means you can intervene and stop something being developed that's totally unrealistic. And also by agreeing to fund research or part fund people's research sessions, they're a lot cheaper than paying a locum. And it means they stay as well. So I think trying to recruit clinical academics to rural areas, it got me here. I hope it would get other people too.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. It's been really interesting hearing the discussion and the questions from colleagues this morning. I'm interested in how we look at policy development for the government in the future. And, preparing for this inquiry, I've accessed loads of papers and research related to remote and rural healthcare, whether it's adults, whether it's children, whether it's maternity. There's a 2007 report in front of me from the Remote and Rural Steering Group. There's been discussions from Lewis Ritchie. There's been Derek Feely papers. There's been... I remember Jason Leach talking about the Nuka healthcare system in Alaska that was being used to develop rural healthcare in Scotland. So that was in 2000. So that we've been talking about rural and how do we deliver healthcare in remote and rural areas. We've been talking about it for decades, and I'm interested to know, and I know it's complicated, that's why there's so many policy papers that have been discussed as well. So I'm interested in what you think that the Scottish Government must address with current issues that facing the delivery of remote and rural care at the moment. I know it's quite challenging post-COVID, but we've learned from actions of from the pandemic when we immediately switched to near me. So I'm interested to hear your thoughts about current government policy and what we need to do as a matter of urgency.
Will I go first? I'm probably just going to reiterate what's been spoken about before, but I think it's important. And I absolutely agree that there's been so much work done on remote and rural healthcare. I think sometimes we don't learn from what's been done, and there are social, personal and professional dimensions that affect both healthcare delivery if you're a healthcare provider or if you're a recipient of healthcare. And to look at some of the challenges in isolation just doesn't work. And I think that's why we do need a whole systems approach needed to address many of the challenges in terms of delivery of healthcare, recruitment and retention of staff, innovation and development. So, for example, we were just talking about digital health. You know, we can, without having an education element to digital health and making sure that the staff that use digital health solutions are adequately prepared and educated, then it won't be as effective as it could be. So that whole systems approach based on the needs of the population in the remote and rural areas should be a part of that policy making. And I know that is pretty complex, but if we pick off ideas and don't look at them as a whole, then, because we're talking about a social system, then many of these solutions that can be absolutely excellent just won't work.
Can I just pick up on the whole systems approach with Professor Smith? It reminded me about some of the challenges that we've experienced with local casework, like the bus from Stranraer to Dumfries doesn't have a toilet on it. And so people were feeding to me that they were avoiding taking their diuretic on their way to a hospital appointment, which they shouldn't be doing. And so, and actually I need to remind everybody that I'm a registered general nurse, and so I've in Dumfries and Galloway, which is quite remote and rural in many of the places. So a whole systems approach makes me think about, like, we've asked for a toilet on the bus, but the bus company or the regional transport partnership aren't even on the integration joint board or part of the health and social care partnership. So that means that there's obviously part of that system isn't connecting if people are avoiding taking medicine just because because their bus journey might be 2 hours and there isn't availability for a loo. So that's an example of where I think part of the system isn't working right now.
I agree. I think there's a lot of patients not taking their diuretics before hospital appointments because it's taken a long time to get to where they need to be. I think Dr. McLean's wanting to come in, is she?
I just want to agree with the points made and talk a bit about, you know, the infrastructure of remote rural areas really needs to be supported for the healthcare workforce and for patients and communities to be able to have access to what they need. And that's an absolute dimension of supporting health and wellbeing within these communities. The social dimensions of health, really, really important, looking at that and redesign that's not afraid to break the mould and actively involve patients and frontline healthcare professionals is so important. the digital integration of data, so allow data flow between primary and secondary care, not just VC appointments, but looking at wider systems within that digital healthcare system as well, and importance of looking at underrepresented and marginalised communities within remote rural areas who may be at increased risk of further health inequity because of where they live remote and rurally. But yes, just agreeing with what Professor Smith said as well about the whole systems approach rather than little models of what's going well, which is important, but we need to have that whole systems approach and the infrastructure there in order to be able to deliver good health and social care within these communities.
Does the new national Centre for Remote and Rural Healthcare need to have an advocacy role to help address some of the challenges that people might bring to issues around their healthcare, whether it is adult, children, maternity? I mean, I'm interested in about how do we advocate for patients when they are feeding into the system so that then the system reacts?
So I suppose in relation to the National Centre, there needs to be a patient voice because if the National Centre is addressing and finding solutions to health and social care problems in remote and rural areas, the patient's voice and the community voice is absolutely central to that. And I know that was part of Professor Ritchie's report, the original report when the centre was proposed. So, you know, I think that's absolutely crucial to the centre's success. It's not just about the healthcare practitioners, it's about the remote and rural communities.
And Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. Just a declaration of interest as a practicing NHS GP. I'd like to start by asking about primary care. So obviously that's a focus of mine. And I'd like to ask the panel, especially Dr. McLean, because you've mentioned it, what do you feel that the GP contract that was introduced by the Scottish Government did to rural primary care? Is it positive or negative?
I don't know if I can speak to for the whole of rural primary care. I know it's had positive and negative. So I know for some of the GP contract, it took away some of the specific things that GPs used to do. So vaccinations, things like that. It created local centralised sort of rooms for people to go and get their vaccinations and things like that, dressings done, wound care. And for urban settings, that works quite well because there's lots of healthcare centres. For rural and remote areas, perhaps didn't work quite so well. That method and that model of care provision. So for somebody elderly who maybe lives quite rurally and will go to their GP on the bus that only comes once a week, and they would go to get their vaccinations or flu vaccinations, maybe get a wound dressing, things like that, making a more centralised location for patients to get that was perhaps not the most useful thing for patient outcomes, as they maybe had to now travel to Inverness rather than staying within their local area in order to go and get these vaccinations. Also for people and patients who maybe had more chaotic lives, opportunistic vaccinations of maybe parents with young children, forget their babies' vaccinations, things like that, that for a trip to their GP in their local area was more accessible than actually going to a specific room designated to go and do this. With regards to the community link workers scheme that's being rolled out in Highland, as I said earlier on, we're evaluating that at the moment. So hopefully we'll have more information about that at a later date next year. But for my part, that's as much as I can tell you that I know about the GP contract in rural areas.
think... The rural GP contract, I'm not a GP, I'm friends with GPs, I go to the GP cluster meeting, I work closely with them. I don't think the current rural GP contract's been well received by our local GPs. It certainly the vaccinations, the loss of vaccinations has, I don't think has worked well in Highland, in the remote areas. And logistically, we're hearing of people driving for three hours to give one vaccination. The centralisation just hasn't... You can't centralise things when the centre is 200 miles away. It doesn't work. And I'm aware that the local rural GPs don't feel the contract's working for them. I know the BMA GP committees, there are many organisations that can speak for rural GPs better than I can.
Thank you very much. And certainly that was an interesting point that you made, Dr. Macon, because I've been told of rural patients who've decided not to get their children's measles vaccinations because they said, well, it's a three-hour round trip, and quite frankly, we don't see anyone. So what's the point? Which terrifies me that we're not getting measles vaccines done. One of the other things about primary care that I've been looking at is the percentage change in income allocation with the new contract. So if you're in the urban belt, in general, we've seen an increase in the amount of money that you're getting. And in more rural areas, it doesn't seem that increase has happened. So it almost seems as though we're trying to promote general practice and primary care in those urban settings, which admittedly 80% of the population live there. But we do have a substantial proportion of people, 20%, who live in those rural areas. So what would you propose that we do for primary care to make things better for people who live in rural areas? And I'd open up to anyone who would like to answer.
I think the stability of GP practices in rural areas is important to consider. And I mean, my answer is simple. I would ask the GPs who are delivering care in these areas about the most effective way to sustain these services.
Thank you. Dr. Macon, sorry, you wanted to come in as well.
I think my colleague on the local caseness hub might say the easy win is just let us do the vaccinations again. We were doing them cheaper and better than Highland was. In terms of, there's obviously far more to it than that. But I'm
certainly coming back at that, looking at the amount of money being offered to GPs to do that, it seems that those costs are going to be not very much being offered to GPs to do it, which makes it very difficult for them to do. And you mentioned Highlands. There's been a big report about bullying in the Highland Health Boards. Now, I'm not going to talk about Western Isles, Professor Smith, because I haven't heard anything from there, but certainly from Highland Health Board. So with this endemic culture, which is what the report found, how can we see a better integrated rural healthcare moving forwards? If your answer to me about primary care was speaking to those on the ground and getting things done, I assume it's very similar in secondary care. So with these issues, how are we going to move forwards?
Personally, I joined NHS Highland very shortly after the report was published, and I've noticed the changes. There's been a big effort in the organisation to address the bullying culture to the extent I wouldn't have known. I don't recognise the organisation from the report. And that said, moving forward, I don't think that I suspect engagement with the GPs through the cluster meetings in a, in more of a policy level and in on a higher level when I go to our local GP cluster, sort of unofficially, but I do go, and it can very often feel like they're being talked down at by the health board, or rather than the health board consulting GPs. And I think the health board then, you're certainly on the vaccination discussions, has been, well, this is what we have to do. We don't have any choice about it. And we know it's not working. So I don't know if that's something that was consulted on just in the central belt, and then if we're trying to rule it out and impose it on rural areas. In terms of moving forward, In terms of moving forward, I think a lot of the pressure on the health service in hospital inpatient care comes from the fact we're the default social care provider in a crisis. Half of my ward at the moment is someone delay. I've got 22 beds in my ward, I've got 22 in the other ward. I think we've got about a third of those are people waiting for social care. If that's putting pressure on the acute services, which is again putting pressure on general practice. I don't know how much of a pressure comes on GPs from the lack of social care, because they tell me it does, but I don't know if it's their biggest pressure. If I could make one point, is we either need to make a decision about are we providing social care or care at home or to everyone, or are we going to say to people you can't have it in certain areas, in which case should we be open about it? And maybe if you're thinking of retiring somewhere, should you be able to look up on a map, can you get social care in this area? And at the moment, you can't do that, but that's slightly different to your point, I appreciate.
Thank you very much. And just my final question, if I may. I want to touch upon the thrombectomy that you spoke about. We're still struggling in Glasgow to get thrombectomy. And that's a very rural, urban area. But I want to touch back upon Caithness and the issues that we're having with maternity services, the downgrade and things not being upgraded again, that you spoke of right at the beginning. I'd like to hear from yourself, Dr. Makin, if I may, about, you said that you're not a woman giving birth, that's true, but you must have patients that you've spoken to that are worried about this. And, what pressures does this put upon people in the area, and what solutions could be put in place to try to help?
It puts you're right, I'm not a pregnant woman, and I'm the only man on the panel. I certainly don't want to be speaking over women. But living in Caithness, it does put a lot of stress on people. No one, I'm also aware of the issues with the former service, and no one wants to go into labour with a healthy pregnancy and a baby doing well and come out and leave hospital without a baby. And that was the risk, that was the concern, that it was not safe. At a personal level, when one of my colleagues' wives was pregnant and he didn't have a car, we sort of had a reverse on-call rotor. If she went into labour, the consultant who wasn't on call would have to drive her to Inverness. But then we found somebody in Inverness you could stay with for a few weeks. The delivering a consultant-led maternity, all bells and whistles, safe maternity service in the rural general hospitals. So there's five rural general hospitals, which have around 40 beds and no paediatrics, is always going to be a challenge. The Island hospitals deliver a little bit more, but after an extremely high expense. I have heard off the record how much Shetland spend on having an obstetrician available. And I'm not going to say, but it's eye-watering. And then they're not going to have paediatrics. So I don't see if we're going to reintroduce maternity services to the rural generals, as in full maternity services, do we accept a risk to babies, or do we spend a vast amount of money? Or if we accept that the only way to have safe services is to centralise, then women are going to have to be some distance away from their families during the later stages of their pregnancy. And it's very difficult, and at the moment there's not a lot of support available for them. You know, there's accommodation for a short period of time, but do we need to look at supporting women more if they are going to need to spend the last 2 weeks of their pregnancy in Inverness? But at the moment, it's all done socially. I think the mother I've heard of mothers planning when they'll be in too much established labour to be transferred, and they just turn up to A&E in labour. And as the consultant on call would be resuscitating their baby, I'm a geriatrician. That terrifies me, and I don't know if they know that, but I've heard it on the local Facebook group. I've heard of women even putting off having children because they don't want to face giving birth. If you're a single parent and you're having your second child, who's going to look after your first if you have to stay in Inverness for 2 weeks? There isn't really any arrangement for that. It's all done remotely. It's all done, you know, ad hoc and on invasive networks. But we've got a choice between, do we accept a substandard service that's dangerous, that could be dangerous, or do we make people uncomfortable and have to travel? And I know no one in Highland wants to provide a substandard service. And I have to say, I worked in Cumbria around the time of the Kirkup report, and the response to NHS Highland to the critical incident that led to the maternity service being withdrawn was exemplary. No effort to hide it, no cover-up, very open investigation. Certainly a world away from other areas where maternity issues were not raised. And I think the opinion of a geriatrician is largely irrelevant, but I think the way they handled the safety concerns openly is actually something they should be praised for. Because I've been reading the newspapers, reading news online about maternity service investigations in England, where it's not been handled openly. And I don't know if women are willing to accept a more dangerous service for convenience. And the women who are probably the ones who are socioeconomically deprived and can't afford to access a better, safer service. But I'd be very keen for the women on the panel to offer an opinion.
Thank you to the panel for their additional service to the committee and remaining online for an additional 15 minutes. We're very grateful for the evidence that you've given us today. And we'll now move on to our next item, which is consideration of two negative instruments. The first instrument is the Food Scotland Act 2015 Compliance Notices Amendment Regulations 2023. The purpose of the instrument is to correct an error in the Food Scotland Act 2015 Hello. Compliance Notices Hello. Regulations 2023, specifically to substitute an incorrect reference to Regulation 6, brackets 2, of the Novel Foods Scotland Regulations 2017 with a reference to Regulation 4 of those regulations. Policy notes states that the correction will allow authorised officers to use compliance notices to deal with breaches of the requirements in the Novel Foods Scotland Regulations 2017. The Delegated Power and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 21st of November 2023 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. No motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Do members have any comments? Ivan McKee.
Thank you, convener. I don't have any issue with the substance of the legislation. It's more a comment on process, and maybe ask the clerks to go and do some background work on this. I'm interested. Clearly, this issue has arisen because there was an error in the drafting of the legislation. I suppose I'd be interested to get a bit more background on how often this happens, what process improvements are looked at to reduce the number of times it happens, what is the process for finding them, how was this one found, and I suppose what is the risk of these kind of errors not being found in legislation that's already been considered. So I say I'd be grateful if there's any work that data the clerks can pull together on that aspect. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McKee. I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this?
No. Thank you. The second instrument is the Feed Additives Authorisation Scotland Regulations 2023. The purpose of this instrument is to implement the decision made by the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health on 13 feed additive applications. It authorises the placing on the market and use in Scotland of 10 new feed additives, renews two authorisations with modifications, and renews, modifies and authorises a new use for one other additive. This instrument also includes a transitional provision concerning an existing authorisation for one feed additive, which is renewed subject to a modification by the instrument. The policy note states that the instrument aligns Scotland with England and Wales and with similar EU legislation for these food additives. It also states that the Food Standards Scotland and the Food Standards Agency have concluded that each feed additive as described in the applications are safe for the targeted species, users, consumers and the environment. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 21st of November 2023 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. No motion to annul has been received in relation to the instrument, and do members have any comments? I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? Thank you. At our next meeting, we'll be continuing our inquiry into healthcare in remote and rural areas, hearing from a panel of representatives of healthcare professionals operating in remote and rural areas. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.